This meeting to the Williamsburg James City County School Board to order. Can I please have a motion to certify closed session?
Madam Chair, I certify that to the best of each member's knowledge, the Williamsburg James City County School Board, while in closed session, discussed only public business matters lawfully exempted from open meeting requirements as stated in Virginia law, and that only such public matters as were identified in the motion convening the closed meeting were heard, discussed, or considered.
Have a second?
Second.
Sarza, can you call the roll, please?
Ms. Hummel?
Aye.
Mr. Kelly?
Aye.
Ms. Ownby?
Aye.
Mrs. Taylor?
Aye.
Mrs. Young?
Aye.
Ms. Cook?
Aye. Item 3.01, I'd like to open the public hearing on the fiscal year 2018 budget. Ms. Hummel? Would you like to read your statement?
Oh, okay. Fiscal year.
Public hearing?
I'm sorry. I thought that, so this is what you want me to talk, oh, I thought it was, that was under board comments. Sorry, I thought that was under announcements and superintendent's report.
No. This is to read the instructions to the public.
Never mind, everyone. I'm sorry. Okay. This is the time when citizens who have submitted speaker cards are invited to address the board. Speakers are asked to come to the podium when their names are called, state their name for the record, and direct their comments to the chair of the board. Each speaker is allocated 3 minutes. Time cannot be yielded to another speaker. Personnel matters are not discussed in open school board meetings, and we ask that you refrain from making reference to specific individuals. The board is interested in hearing all comments fully and requests that citizens refrain from verbal outbursts, applause, or any other type of demonstration. Although the board does not respond to comments at this time, please know that we are listening and appreciate your time. Thank you for adhering to these guidelines. Madam Chair, my directions are concluded.
Thank you, Ms. Hummel.
Jay Everson, please.
Good evening. Jay Everson, 103 Branscombe Boulevard in the Berkeley District, ably represented by Mrs. Young. I just wanted to say that I see Ms. Karen Swan is here, and she was the principal, vice principal, and then the principal of Berkeley when my grandkids were there, and I was the reflections chair of the PTA, and it was a very good experience with her, and I just wanted to say something on her behalf. I know you're not supposed to talk about people here, but I thought that would be okay. I did want to talk about the budget. A couple of months ago, you approved the CIP, and I gather it's about $4 million over what the county had said that they would like to have that number be. And at the time, the vice chair, now the current chair, had indicated that that the board is required by to have a budget of need. That's statutory language. And it seems to me that given that the county has made it quite clear on the CIP budget, the number, and the number for the operating budget, that in the interest of reducing conflict with the funding bodies, that this board should come in with budgets that are consistent with those numbers at this point, rather than send a budget to them in the future. Send a budget to them that's higher and then have to come back in the future and cut it. It seems to me that the budget of need should be based on what you need given the financial parameters provided by the county. And I would hope that you would produce a budget that was consistent with the direction provided by the county to you all. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Everson. That closes our public hearing and allows us to move on to item 4.01, which is the Pledge of Allegiance. Gabriel Brown, will you come up, please? Gabriel is a 10th grader at Jamestown High School, and he loves to play the violin, and we are delighted to have him up here to lead us in the pledge this evening.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America
and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Gabriel. Ms. Lerza, will you please call the roll?
Ms. Hummel.
Here.
Mr. Kelly.
Here.
Ms. Ownby.
Here.
Mrs. Taylor.
Here.
Mrs. Young.
Here.
Ms. Cook.
Here. And we'd like to all let everybody know that the board wishes Dr. Beers, who could not be with us tonight, a speedy recovery. That brings us to item 4.03, approval of the agenda. Can I have a motion? Taylor?
Yes, I move to approve the agenda with the following amendments. I would like to add 9.04, budget calendar revisions, and 9.05, personnel actions.
So second?
Second.
So it's been moved and seconded to approve the agenda as presented, removing 8.04 from personnel actions and moving it to 9.05, and then adding 9.04 budget calendar revision. Sirza, will you call the roll, please?
Mrs. Young.
Aye.
Ms. Hummel.
Aye.
Mr. Kelly.
Aye.
Ms. Ownby.
Aye.
Mrs. Taylor.
Aye.
Ms. Cook.
Aye. And that brings us to item 5.01, announcements and superintendent's report. Dr. Heron.
Good evening, Madam Chair. Today, the WJCC Schools Foundation awarded over $30,000 in grants to 33 WJCC teachers, impacting almost 8,000 of the division students. The Foundation's innovative learning grants provide resources for teachers that enrich the learning experiences for our students and inspire innovation in the classroom. I want to thank the Foundation for their incredible support of our teachers and our schools, and also congratulate the WJCC staff members who were awarded a grant today. As you know, last week we missed 3 instructional days due to snow, and I'd like to thank the Operations and Transportation Departments for their efforts in getting us back to school as quickly and as safely as possible. Mr. Snipe and his team do an incredible job looking after us. As of today, we do not plan on adjusting the school calendar. However, if we miss more days, we will have to look at options to make up instructional time. Last week, WJCC students participated in the first division-wide science fair, and students who placed in that competition will go on to the Tidewater Science Fair at ODU on March 11th. This is the first time WJCC will be represented at the Tidewater Science Fair, and we will be sure to share those results with you when we get them. In June 2017, Tuano Middle School choir students will step on stage at Carnegie Hall in New York City as part of Distinguished Choirs International of New York. Students will rehearse and perform music by composer and conductor Francisco Nanez, and will have opportunities to experience some of New York City's music, art, and culture firsthand. The choir, under the direction of Valerie Hart, is currently seeking support for the trip, and anyone interested in learning more about that should visit the TMS website at wjccschools.org/TMS. Madam Chair, those are all of the announcements I have this evening.
Thank you, Dr. Heron. Mr. Kelly, do you have anything to share this evening?
Superintendent search is still progressing. We have had 29 applications so far from around the country from a diverse pool of candidates. We'll be moving into the position closes on Friday, and we will be moving smartly into the selection process next week.
Thank you very much. Ms. Ownby, do you have anything that you'd like to share this evening?
Yes, I wanted to give an update on the most recent SEAC meeting, that's the Special Education Advisory Committee. I am the board liaison. They held their regular meeting on January 12th. They adopted a new format for speaker comments to allow for accommodations for persons with disabilities. So they will allow an additional 3 minutes when folks provide public comment at SEAC meetings and or for folks to have someone read their public comments for them if that is necessary. They will be recommending in their annual report to us that we adopt a similar public comment accommodations for folks with disabilities to ensure accessibility. They plan to ask the Board of Supervisors as well to adopt similar public speaking policies. We heard an update from the state SEAC, the Special Education Advisory Committee. They're preparing for new teacher certification that's required as a result of last year's General Assembly bill that was passed to require teachers to be certified in identifying students with dyslexia. Folks at William & Mary are working on that credentialing process right now, and that will take effect this July. Parks and Rec gave an update. Their Destination Recreation Symposium will be on February 25th, so that's a phenomenal resource for families to understand options in Parks and Rec for their students, as well as summer options. That's from 9 to 12 on February 25th. Parks and Rec is also hosting a first-time sensory pool night. It'll be after hours for children who could benefit from a sensory experience, so they'll have low lights, they'll allow floats in the pools, in the pool, which is something they don't typically do. There'll be a $3 fee. Folks can get information at Parks and Rec or online if that's something that their child would enjoy. SEAC plans to update their bylaws soon. They appointed a new secretary. They had a representative come and speak from the Department of Education who provided guidance and information on the purpose of SEAC, which is to serve as an advisory committee to our school board, producing at least an annual report on the needs of students with developmental disabilities in our division. I did want to share some accolades. The representative from VDOE was very impressed with the number of folks in attendance at SEAC, as well as the breadth and the diversity of folks who were in attendance that night. One recommendation that he did have was to consider including students, particularly students with special needs or disabilities, on the SEAC. So hopefully that's something that will be considered. He also gave props to Dr. Barreau. Just wanted to say props to you. He was very impressed with her. She's always very helpful and responsive when the state contacts her. PTC, which is the Parent Education Advocacy and Training Center, in conjunction with VDOE, is hosting an advocacy training day on April 11th and 12th in Richmond. This is an all-expense paid advocacy training experience for families who have students with disabilities. There's information on the VDOE website if folks are interested in applying for that. And One Child Center for Autism is hosting a monthly respite night at WISC for students with special needs and their typically developing peers. More information is on the One Child Center for Autism website. There are lots of resources in this community, and one of the things that was discussed at the SEAC meeting was their role in pulling together these resources in a web-based format so folks are aware of all the options for families. The next meeting will be on February 9th at 6:30 at the Rec Center, and is always open to the public. We encourage folks to come. One other thing, wanted to feather in our cap, VDOE rep was very impressed that there was a school board liaison. As he's traveled across the state, he could not recall any other SEAC that had a school board liaison. So he was impressed with that.
Thank you, Ms. Ombi.
Thank you.
Ms. Hummel, would you like to share anything?
Yes, now I will share it at the appropriate time that I am supposed to share it. It is recommended that school boards actually assess themselves once a year. So Jim Beers, who couldn't be here tonight, drafted a school board self-assessment survey, and then he shared that with all of us. We all gave him our input, and now I am going to take that survey and put it into a Qualtrics anonymous survey that I will be sending all of you a link later on in the next couple days, and if you could have it completed by February 1st, it would be much appreciated.
Thank you, Ms. Hummel. Are there any other announcements at this time? That brings us to item 6.01, board recognitions. Dr. Heron.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Tonight we have five Jamestown athletes to recognize, and they were all named to a VHSL All-State team. Students, as your name is called, please proceed to the front to be recognized and remain for a group photo. First student, Maria Esch and Elizabeth Polpilka, All-State Volleyball First Team. Thank you. Hannah Piatak, All-State Volleyball Second Team. Thorin Jean, All-State Cross Country. Katie Kirby, All-State Competitive Cheer. Congratulations. Madam Chair, these are all of the recognitions we have this evening, and we anticipate more at the next February board meeting.
That brings us to item 6.02, School Spotlight. Dr. Heron?
Thank you, Madam Chair. This evening we are delighted to have Jamestown High School with us. Dr. Kathy Worley will be presenting the Exceptional Eagles Program. Thank you, Dr. Worley.
Good evening, Dr. Heron, Madam Chair, members of the board. Thank you for having us here this evening. It's an honor to be here. And I am very proud of my teachers and students who have founded the Exceptional Eagles Club at our school this year. And I am not going to speak about it. I'm going to turn it over to them because they have a great message to share with you this evening. Coach Brown will introduce his staff members and the students.
Good evening. First and foremost, thank you for having us here. Thank you to our administration for supporting us through this, our endeavors with the Exceptional Eagles Club. First and foremost, I want to announce the co-sponsors, teachers. I have Ronnell Brown, who is our curriculum lead inclusion teacher, Miss Missy Furr. She's an art teacher here at the high school. Catherine Peterkin is also an inclusion teacher here with us today. That helped sponsor the club and got it started. Today, I'm not gonna spend too much about the Exceptional Eagles Club because the students really came to us about it. They wanted to help out students with disabilities and help mainstream them into the general population as far as social activities and not just educational. So Connor Gilfillan and Sam Lee, they're gonna lead us through our PowerPoint presentation.
Tonight we have the Exceptional Eagles Club at Jamestown High School. We're a club that aims to promote the awareness and the acceptance of students with disability. We're out here, we got kids both with and without disability, just hanging out bowling on a Monday night.
It started with some interest from some students who wanted to work with students with disability, also some teachers who had some background, they wanted to work with students with disability, and we just found that there was a need to find ways to reach out and get students with disability to go out to social activities, to go to games, and do different things. So we're very excited. This is one of our major events, first big events, so we're very excited.
Everybody needs to have like a high school experience, and a lot of times kids sometimes feel awkward or maybe feel like they're not invited or included in other things. So I think it's really important to know that there's a community of people that want to get together and they want to go out and do other things.
Our mission as the Exceptional Eagles is to create a united community by celebrating individualism, acceptance, and diversity.
So our overall goals are basically just to kind of create a community where everyone celebrates their differences and just comes together and just appreciates everyone for who they are. And it's also to not only just incorporate everyone and have them feel welcomed, it's also to educate other students so that they learn about the differences and learn to accept everyone for those differences. So one event that we did was the Sleigh Bell 5K, and we kind of just all got together, and we actually had Jamestown High School on our shirts, and we just went out there to support the club. And then we also have Monday night bowling nights where we all come out and just have a good time. And these are some pictures that are from the night, which you got a little snippet of in the video. So another thing we like to do is Mondays during, we have AEP when we have, I think, 25 minutes, and we have two separate groups where we'll go in and they have a girls group and then another group, and we learn about social skills and how to interact with everyone, and it's just kind of to show everyone how to kind of talk to everyone else in the school and create relationships.
Tonight we have some students with us who have directly impacted or been impacted by the Exceptional Eagles Club that will come up and share their views on the club.
So I had to write it down because I had a short note. Well, I couldn't really, like, have it all at one time. Well, whatever, I can't talk. So it says, "Hi, I'm Meredith. I am here to tell you about how my experience with you young Exceptional Eagles. This lonely path through this maze has many traps. My friends from this club have helped me find my way through this clearing. I am thankful for the numerous times of helping me find my way around this maze of obstacles. Let us keep helping others find their way to the clearing. Thank you very much."
I've been accepted because I felt like I was part of the family. And bowling was a lot of fun. It helped me get out of the house, not be on my electronics a lot, not like stay home all day, all night, just sleep in.
So have you made?
I made a lot of friends at Jamestown, but I still miss my old school at Lafayette. So I'll be able. I like Jamestown a lot better.
But we're still cool, right?
Yeah.
Yes.
And I really thank you all for make me feel part of the family. Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Gabriel, and the reason why I decided to join the Exceptional Eagles Club is because I like bowling, and I made a lot of friends. Because I like to socialize with them. And I also had sleepover on my birthday.
Is that all?
Yes.
Hi, I'm Connor Gilfillan, and I have a sister named Gigi who goes to Claire Bird Baker. She has special needs, and she likes to play basketball, sing, dance, and socialize. I hope to keep this club moving so that when she's in high school, she can participate in activities like bowling night and the exceptional games. The club is already moving better than we thought it would, and we hope to launch a branch in each school in the county. Once this is done, we'd like to hold an annual exceptional games at the end of the school year in which kids of all ages with special needs can participate in games, and they can participate in basketball, swimming, and soccer games and races and stuff like that.
Okay, so one more thing that we're planning on doing is March 6th is kind of raise awareness about the R word and to get rid of it. So we, as a school, have decided to make a banner of a pledge. And basically the pledge says, I pledge and support the elimination of the derogatory use of the R word and promote the acceptance and inclusion of all students. And it's going to be put on, I think, like a 12-foot by 2.5-foot banner that will hang, will have during lunches, we were going to have all the students sign it, so that we're going to hang it up so that everyone kind of it raises awareness and it just promotes the elimination of the word. And so one thing we invite you guys as the school board to do, we have a little pledge that we would love you all to sign as kind of a, so you're the first ones to sign it, and it would be nice to frame it and hang it up next to our big banner. So I would like to invite you all to sign it.
Come on.
We don't fight.
Some of us do.
That's cool.
Thank you so much for having us and joining our quest to eliminate the derogatory term. We call it the R word. We teach our students not even to say the word anymore, but the R word. Appreciate it. If you need to reach us for any questions, feel free to contact us. Thank you.
Anyone have any comments?
I just would love to applaud your efforts as a sibling of a young man who was born with significant disabilities in 1972. I think what your students have done is phenomenal. So thank you so much. My daughter is a Lafayette student, 10th grader, but when she was in Hornsby, she and one of her buddies did a similar kind of presentation 3 years ago to eliminate the R word. So I applaud your efforts, and I hope that it can go division-wide, and anything that the school board can do to recreate your banner and hang that banner at each and every one of our 15 schools. Thank you, thank you, thank you.
I just want to say that I had the pleasure of running alongside several of you at the sleigh bell, and so it was a very festive group. And it was cold, so it was nice to be near such happy people. So, That brings us to item 7.01, citizens' comments. Ms. Hummel.
Got it. I'm on it right now. Okay. So this is the second time tonight when citizens who have submitted speaker cards are invited to address the board. Speakers are asked to come to the podium when their names are called, state their name for the record, and direct their comments to the chair of the board. Each speaker is allocated 3 minutes. Time cannot be yielded to another speaker. Personnel matters are not discussed in open school board meetings, and we ask that you refrain from making reference to specific individuals. The board is interested in hearing all comments fully and requests that citizens refrain from verbal outbursts, applause, or any other type of demonstration. Although the board does not respond to comments at this time, please know that we are listening and we appreciate your time. Thank you for adhering to these guidelines. Madam Chair, my directions are concluded.
Thank you, Ms. Hummel.
Ariel Ben-Yashe. I hope I got that right.
I'm Ariel Ben-Yashe. I just wanted to offer some concerns about the middle school football program. I know I've shared some of those with all of you before. I wanted to say thank you for having heard those, and thanks to the school administration for offering some really important first steps. I was really heartened by those, but I think that there are some really important next steps for everyone to consider. You know, there are lots of new rules for playing football. There's lots of new efforts to train coaches better, to upgrade equipment, and to adopt new impact assessments and new tools to help us recognize concussions. And yet, at the same time, all of those interventions have been shown to only slightly reduce concussions and other head trauma. And I ask myself, how can that be? And, you know, we've bought better helmets, we've taught coaches and students how to tackle more appropriately. We've even limited the amount of practice time that students have that's full contact. But the reality is that these are only now showing very limited effects on concussions. And the concussion rate among middle school football players is still way too high. This isn't something, you know, that's necessarily intentional. Coaches are doing their best to recognize concussions when they're occurring on the field. And yet, the signs of concussions are really too subtle for coaches to recognize, even trained ones. There are now several studies showing that, you know, for every concussion that's reported by either a coach or even by the players themselves, there are 7 concussions that are not being reported, but yet being observed by physicians who are watching the games off the field. You know, the other piece of this is that the focus is really only on concussions and not on the repeated hits to the head that don't quite rise to the concussion level. There's a lot of evidence now that even these subconcussive hits, when they are occurring as regularly and in such impact as they are, still lead to tremendous long-term damage. I want to just leave you with just one thought, and that is that the impact of this head trauma isn't just being felt by these student athletes in the days and weeks immediately after. There is now a mounting evidence suggesting that this is associated with all sorts of really awful long-term damage. Things like impaired cognitive ability in adulthood, higher levels of depression, higher levels of incarceration, and I think most dishearteningly, higher levels of suicide among football players, especially those that began playing before 14 years of age. So I just want to leave you, you know, thinking with a very simple question. How is it that our schools, which are the place that we nurture our children's brains and minds, are also a place that we're supporting, you know, activities that lead to regular and pervasive brain damage? So thank you very much for your time.
Kim Hunley.
Good evening and Happy New Year. I just wanted to bring just a little remarks about the budget from the Education Association. It was a pleasure for me to be able to sit in and see how that works again for the second year. And it's nice to see that your main goal is keeping children, the needs of the children first, and especially where you place the dots, and I was watching very, very carefully. I went to see Hidden Figures, And, you know, we think this task of the budget is a big one, but just, you know, think about what they went through trying to get someone to the moon. I mean, you have to have that teamwork, open mind, have your goal. And I think that I definitely saw that with each and every one of you as you were working towards that in your cabinet as well with the information they brought forth. So we just wanted you to know as an association, we're here if you need our help. We've given you a little budget survival packet. The quote is by Rummy, and it says, "The lamps are different, but the light is the same." And each of you bring a different perspective to the budget. As you know, some of your dots were in different places, but and things are going to change as legislative and the governor puts forth some new information. Things are going to be constantly changing. But as long as we keep the kids and the programs that affect the kids first, I think everything else will line into place. So not only do you have a little lamp, it kind of turns colors. It's soothing if you get a little frustrated. You have some cinnamon gum, which stimulates the brain. Research has had that. And chocolate, my favorite kind. It's golden, because we really do feel your work is golden. And chocolate, to me, solves everything. So, again, we'll be meeting with Dr. Herring on the budget, and we're here if you need anything. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Chris Henderson.
Good evening, school board. Chris Henderson, 101 Keystone. I just wanted to address you very briefly this evening about the status of your project with regard to the James Blair Middle School replacement. I was pleased to note in the paper that it was reported that the construction estimate had come in lower than originally projected, but that's not always the full extent of the story. And what I would like for the board to do and to consider doing is provide monthly updates or bi-monthly updates as to the status of that project, whether or not we're on time and on budget, most importantly, and then also what is the total project budget. The actual physical construction of the building is but one component of the total project cost. We've had cost in the demolition of the facility, we've had cost regarding the design of the new one, and all of it is baked into the final number. So when we read in the local paper that the project is coming in $4 or $5 million under budget, one has to wonder with a skeptic eye whether or not that is in fact reality, but as the keeper of the budget and the party responsible for maintaining control on project cost and CIP, I would ask that you inform the public as to the status of the project so that we can keep track with you, so that we can know that the dollars are being well spent and that we're living within our budget. I thank you.
Thank you very much. That moves us to the consent agenda, which includes items 8.01, approval of minutes from the January 3rd, 2017 meeting, 8.02, financial report and monthly bills and payroll, November 2016. Item 8.03, financial report and monthly bills and payroll, December 2016. Item 8.04, release from compulsory attendance, case number R17-03. 8.05, resolution R-2-17, career and technical education month. Item 8.06, resolution R-3-17, National School Counseling Week. And finally, item 8.07, resolution R-4-17, African American History Month. May I have a motion, please?
I move to approve the consent agenda as presented.
Second?
Second.
Sirza, any discussion? The consent agenda has been moved and seconded. Please call the roll.
Mrs. Young.
Aye.
Mrs. Hummel.
Aye.
Mr. Kelly.
Aye.
Ms. Ownby.
Aye.
Mrs. Taylor.
Aye.
Ms. Cook.
Aye.
Brings us to item 9.01, VSBA Code of Conduct.
Madam Chair, I move approval of the VSBA Code of Conduct for school board members as presented.
Second. Any discussion? Zombie.
The VSBA Code of Conduct is a minimum standard set forth by the Virginia School Board Association. School boards across the Commonwealth sign and adopt this annually. Some communities personalize their code to ensure that it resonates with their particular community. WJCC has chosen to adopt the State School Board Association Code unchanged. This document is about transparency and outlining for voters and for the community what code of ethics we as school board members will follow. There's one overarching theme. As a member of the WJCC School Board, I will strive to be an advocate for students and to improve public education. And to that end, there are 12 points. All are equally important, and all are a minimum standard for school board members to follow. I'm particularly interested in number one. I will have integrity in all matters and support the full development of all children and the welfare of the community, the Commonwealth, and the nation. So that says to me that I, as a board member, will ensure that I will never, as a board member, put any of our students in jeopardy at any time in any way. Also, number nine jumps out at me. I'll refrain from using the board position for personal or partisan gain and to avoid any conflict of interest or the appearance of impropriety. So this says to me that as a board member, I should not hold leadership a leadership position in a local political party, be beholden to any political party, make board decisions based on political party platforms or agendas, actively campaign as a partisan, or campaign in a partisan way against fellow school board members. I will wholeheartedly follow not only these two items in this code of ethics, but the entire code, and I hope each and every one of our school board members can do the same and will sign off on this code of ethics.
First of all, I believe that the majority of the Virginia School Board Association Code of Conduct is right on target, however, number nine. I am opposed to that because I think it's in violation of the Constitution of the United States. What we're asking school board members to do is to refrain from any other activity outside of the school board. And I'm going to just read what the First Amendment of the Constitution says. It says, Congress shall make no law respecting an establishment of religion or prohibiting the free exercise thereof or abridging the freedom of speech or of the press, or of the right of the people peaceably to assemble and to petition the government for a redress of grievances. This package of the First Amendment cases and activities provides examples of the five pillars of the First Amendment: freedom of religion, speech, press, assembly, and petition. Consider the foundation of the Constitution. And therefore, I will be signing the petition, but I will be exempting myself from number nine.
Mr. Kelly.
Thank you, Madam Chair. It's interesting. In my years here, we've never had a discussion about the code of conduct and haven't, and you know, whether it's appropriate or not. A code of conduct or a code of ethics is an important part of building and trust amongst otherwise disparate people towards a common goal, common understanding, developing trust and working together. Whether it is doctors whose code calls for physicians to practice competently and with respect for the patient's dignity and rights, or lawyers whose code begins with a lawyer shall provide competent representation to a client, or engineers whose code says shall hold paramount the health, safety, and welfare of the public. It is you know, code of conduct, code of ethics is holding yourself to a higher standard, not the legal standard, but an ethical standard, you know, that you are interested in primarily as your school board, your work on the school board is in the interest of teaching and learning. As school board members, I think it is important that we affirm to each other, to the public, that our first priority is to advocate and hold primary the teaching and learning of our students. How can the public trust that we are keeping our primary focus on students if we won't affirm a code of conduct which states that partisan politics is not what we are interested in? How do we trust each other if we do not commit to attending board meetings, coming prepared, and respecting the confidentiality of privileged information? A code of conduct, I'm an engineer, I practice as best I can to the NSP code of ethics, school board code of conduct for school board members. You know, I know that there's things in the community where you have to profess either orally in writing that you intend to support nominees for a public office from a particular group, person, organization. Signing over your right to vote and to make a decision seems to be even more paramount to me than advocating and than advocating that you will not use your position on the board for partisan politics. So I am certainly going to vote in support of the code of conduct for the Virginia School Board Association, and think it's important that we all do.
Just one follow-up comment. It is written into the Code of Virginia that school board members must act independent of any political party. That is the function of a school board, to not be partisan in any way. And so for that reason, I think number 9 is important, and then all of us can sign off on that.
I wanted to just say that I appreciate the discussion that we've had on this topic since it was introduced at the last work session. And I think that, as far as I can remember, the school board has unanimously adopted this code without issue. But I think it's a good thing to not take that for granted and to always take time to examine everything that we do. I've thought about this code a little more deeply as a result of that, and it certainly more deeply than I did the first 2 years I signed it. But this year I will vote for and sign it with more conviction as a result. In my view, my role as a public official necessitates that I behave with more discipline and restraint than I would as a private citizen. Since I've been on the board, I've refrained from activity participating as an advocate, a board member, or an officer in any partisan advocacy or affinity group that could in any way adopt a position, fiscal, policy, or otherwise, regarding the work of this board. And I think that's important. Once my term on this board is over, I will resume the advocacy work that I am passionate about. But in the meantime, I affirm by signing this pledge that I will refrain from using the board position for personal or partisan gain and avoid any conflict of interest or appearance of impropriety. And because, like the VSBA, the Virginia School Board Association, I believe signing it improves relations between us and, more importantly, the community. So I will sign it happily. The VSBA Code of Conduct for School Board Members has been moved and seconded. Sirza, will you call the roll?
Ms. Ownby?
Aye.
Mrs. Taylor?
Aye.
Mrs. Young?
Aye, with the exception of number 9.
Ms. Hummel?
Aye.
Mr. Kelly?
Aye.
Ms. Cook?
Aye. Thank you. The motion passes. Item 9.02, appointment of special education to Special Education Advisory Committee. Can I have a motion, please?
I move that we accept the applicant to the Special Education Advisory Committee as presented.
Second?
Second.
Any discussion? Item 9.02, appointment of Special Education Advisory Committee has been moved and seconded. Sirza, will you call the roll, please?
Mrs. Young?
Aye.
Ms. Hummel?
Aye.
Mr. Kelly?
Aye.
Ms. Ownby?
Aye.
Mrs. Taylor?
Aye.
Ms. Cook?
Aye. Item 9.03, 2017-2018 Program of Studies. May I have a motion, please?
Madam Chair, I move approval of the Program of Studies as the 2017-2018 Program of Studies as presented this evening.
May I have a second?
Second.
Dr. Heron?
Thank you, Madam Chair. As you're aware, there's been lots of questions that we've responded to in the last short period of time about the program of studies, and if there are no other questions, I think we're ready to move forward. If the board has any questions, Ms. Parker's here tonight to address those for you. Thank you.
Two questions, Ms. Parker.
Ms. Parker, thank you.
And I can't find my notes. It wasn't clear to me when I read the program of studies for the innovation grants that any rising ninth grader could apply to that particular school. That language wasn't in there, so that wasn't made clear to me, and I didn't know if that was just part of our rollout that PR will do to let the community know that any rising ninth grader can do that.
That's a question I probably should jump in and answer, that there will be PR and communication and meetings with parents and students at each of the high schools where all of the, it'll be made very obvious then that any student can apply to any school.
Okay. And so will that, do you feel that that's sufficient, that that language doesn't need to be in the program of studies?
Is
it possible to include that in the program of studies if someone like misses that information and they're just looking at it?
It's my understanding from our experience last year with this, we had a pretty broad campaign in place and communication plan in place to educate parents and families as to what that program looks like and who can apply, and I haven't received any concerns or questions about that.
Okay, and then I did receive lots of answers to my questions from last board meeting, but don't recall reading anything. Julie and I both had a question about the early childhood class at Lafayette that was going to be eliminated in the connection to CDR.
Yes, absolutely. And I apologize. I thought that we had sent that in, but
there's what, one class?
The parenting class?
Mm-hmm. Right.
The parenting class is actually the class that is connected.
And that's staying.
And it's continuing. And we went ahead and added, prayer suggestion was great, we went ahead and added a line in there in the course description explaining to students and families about that partnership.
Perfect. And then I forgot there's one last question. So with regard to students with disabilities and what used to be called the modified diploma, now it's the applied diploma, do all students who have an IEP receive that if they're unable to obtain the standard or the advanced diploma? All students?
We have a lot of different options for our students with disabilities in regards to receiving their diploma. So students with disabilities have the option of pursuing the standard diploma with accommodations, and that's going to depend on their IEP team and what accommodations are approved for that student. And I believe your question was in regards to students with maybe more profound or severe disability. For those students, we actually have a different diploma called the Applied Studies Diploma. And that is something different than the standard with accommodations.
So the applied, can they take that one to Thomas Nelson or no?
For the Applied Studies Diploma?
Uh-huh.
It is a diploma, but it is not a standard or advanced standard diploma. So I would have to look at Thomas Nelson.
But it's more like a certificate. It's not really a diploma.
It's a diploma. It's a state Virginia Department of Education diploma. However, it's not a state standard or advanced studies diploma.
Thank you for the clarification.
It's actually a follow-up to Ms. Ownsby. If the information that we were talking about is not put in the program of studies, can we make sure that it, as you're rolling out the information, that all of the policies related to admission into the different programs is put on the website in kind of a clear way that if it's not in the program of studies, it's somewhere else that can be easily found.
Absolutely.
Looking at the old program of studies today, as a matter of fact, and noted that Pathways isn't even in it. It's just how quickly we're innovating. So thank you very much for...
Thank you.
That was just a year ago.
So. Yes, I know.
Anyway, Ms. Serza, will you call the roll, please? It has been moved and seconded to adopt the 2017-2018 program of studies. As presented.
Ms. Ownsby.
Aye.
Mrs. Taylor.
Aye.
Mrs. Young.
Aye.
Ms. Hummel.
Aye.
Mr. Kelly.
Aye.
Ms. Cook.
Aye.
That brings us to item 9.04, budget calendar revision. Dr. Herron.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Ms. Bird has, and I've recommended a revision to the budget calendar. Ms. Bird is going to present that to you now for your consideration.
I apologize. I forgot to ask for a motion. So may I have a motion to adopt the budget calendar revision, and then we'll get to you, Ms. Bird. I'm sorry. Can I have a motion, please?
I move adoption of the budget calendar as modified.
Second. Thank you.
Good evening, Madam Chair, members of the board, Dr. Herron. As we shared with you on Saturday, due to the current goings on in Richmond with the General Assembly, we are recommending that we delay the presentation of the superintendent's proposed budget from February 7th to February 21st. Also on the calendar, we've identified an additional discussion or approval date on March the 28th, should that be necessary to provide you ample time to review the presented budget and or make changes so that we meet the deadline of April 1st presenting to our funding partners.
Thank you, Ms. Berta. Any questions? Cerza, it has been moved and seconded to approve the budget calendar revision as presented. Will you please call the roll?
Mrs. Taylor.
Aye.
Mrs. Young.
Aye.
Ms. Hummel.
Aye.
Mr. Kelly.
Aye.
Ms. Ownby.
Aye.
Ms. Cook.
Aye. Thank you. That brings us to 9.05, which includes two personnel-related actions. Ms. Taylor, may I have a motion, please?
I move the personnel actions as presented.
Second, please. Any discussion? Ms. Cerza, 9.05 personnel actions as presented have been moved and seconded. Could you please call the roll?
Mrs. Young?
Aye.
Ms. Hummel?
Aye.
Mr. Kelly?
Aye.
Ms. Ownby?
Aye.
Mrs. Taylor?
Aye.
Ms. Cook?
Aye. That brings us to the second part of 9.05, personnel actions. Ms. Taylor, can I have a motion, please?
I move to uphold the acting superintendent's proposed disciplinary action of a 5-day suspension without pay regarding employee relations case number 17-01-01 as discussed in closed session.
I have a second. Discussion? Item's been moved and seconded. Can you please call the roll? Thank
you. Ms. Hummel?
Aye.
Mr. Kelly?
Aye.
Ms. Ownby?
Aye.
Mrs. Taylor?
Aye.
Mrs. Young?
Aye.
Ms. Cook?
Aye. Thank you. That brings us to 10.01, design progress update on the Lafayette High School Auxiliary Gymnasium project. Dr. Heron.
Thank you, Madam Chair. This evening, we're going to bring you another update on Lafayette High School Auxiliary Gym Project, and Mr. Snipes is here to introduce the item this evening. Thank you, Mr. Snipes.
Thank you. Good evening, Madam Chair, board members. Dr. Heron, in July of 2016, the board awarded the design of the Lafayette Auxiliary Gym to HBA Architecture, and as recently as December of last year, we were here providing an update in regards to the VE recommendations. Tonight, a representative from the firm is here to provide some final recommendations about the changes that were accepted in the VE. This is Mr. Jack Hastings from HBA.
Hi, good evening. My name is Jack Hastings. I'm an architect with HBA. And last time I was here, I gave you all an update with respect to the decisions that came out of the value engineering process. So since we've met with you, the entire design team has been busy addressing each one of those items that we talked about last time. And basically where we are now, we're currently right on schedule, which we have a copy of the schedule, which we'll show you. And also to look ahead for the next 30 days or so, and this time frame will be really important. We'll be talking a lot with purchasing to define bidding requirements. So we're really at the tail end of the design phase of the project, and we're working towards that, towards a end of February, 1st of March release for bid documents. So the next series of slides deals with, the first two sets deal with the conditions the way we showed them last time we were here, and then today's image reflecting where we are from a site plan and a building plan standpoint. So this is the image indicating where we were last time for the site plan, showing the access road for the fire lane dashed. And then with respect to where we are today, you can see the enhanced fire lane, which connects from the auxiliary gym addition to the parking area. We've also since we met with you, we've also submitted to the county for site plan review. Which includes the stormwater management features, which are to the right and to the left of the gymnasium. We're also talking with the school division about four storage sheds that need to be shifted to allow for the construction of the access road, and that's some work that's currently being discussed. So part of the value engineering component was to actually delete one of the vestibules, which is in the upper right-hand corner of the floor plan, and also to reduce the width of the storage area, once again, to save square footage and to save construction cost. So the new floor plan basically shows that the vestibule has been removed in the upper right-hand corner. The storage room originally was proposed to be reduced by 6 feet. There were some complications related to the roofing, which allowed it to only be reduced by 4 feet. So it's actually a little bit bigger than what we had talked about previously. So the building elevations basically have stayed the same. Storage area, roofing has reduced a little bit. For the most part, the building elevations are exactly as they were proposed last time. And then our value engineering summary, and all we've done here is simply to highlight the three major items that we dealt with, that I've talked about, which is the vestibules, the storage room, and then the bottom line item relates to a connecting corridor canopy that we've reduced or simplified the design of the canopy, just once again to save construction cost. Those items are highlighted in the VE summary. And then lastly, our timeline. This timeline, we're right on target in terms of our schedule, showing our January 2017 first board meeting concerning the final design for the project. So we're right on target with respect to design progress. Are there any questions?
Not yet.
There are no questions.
Okay. I didn't know you. Are you finished?
I am, yes.
Okay, well, now I have questions.
Okay.
The storage sheds, do they remain after the gym is finished?
Well, that's something necessary? That we're currently working on. For one, to verify that they're still active. That's the first question. And then if so, if they need to remain, can any of the materials that are currently being stored, are they candidates to move into the new building? Which would be nice if
right.
But that's something that we're currently assessing.
What's your stormwater management structures look like?
Well, they're very natural looking. They're really termed bioretention areas. So they're basically natural swales that will receive the stormwater.
Okay, so they're above ground?
They are above ground.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Are they fenced off, restricted access, or? Are they not deep enough to do that?
They're basically low slope swales, which for the most part, there is something similar that's out there on site now. If you're familiar with the tennis courts, there's a low slope swale that is on the perimeter of the tennis courts. It's very similar to that, but it basically creates a larger rectilinear area. The area around the tennis courts are very linear, but ours are a little more rectilinear in shape, but they're low slope and not deep.
I do know what rectilinear means. The swales are to collect the water that comes off the roof, so it's not a very large area that it's doing. Okay. And we think we're on schedule for a 2018 opening so far.
We're on target, and one of the benefits of the VE effort was to provide some alternate bid items,
right?
And that'll give us some flexibility with respect to maintaining our budget at bid day.
Sure.
And those are items that the bids are received and they're within funds available. Those items can be retained within the project.
Thank you. Thank you, Madam Chair.
Thank you, and I see that there's been a reduction in the base bid of about $204,949. What is going to be the overall cost of the auxiliary gym?
Bids aren't in yet.
Yeah, right now, if you were to take all of the value engineering items that are indicated, we are actually below budget in terms of where we are with our estimate. And all of that is done on purpose because there's some unusual soil conditions where the building addition is going. So we are basically creating a contingency through the scope of the work to make sure that there's enough money in the project to address some uncertain soil conditions.
And then just anecdotal information, I'm pretty sure at least one of the sheds is used by the PTA.
Uh-huh.
So I would get confirmation from Lafayette.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Haston. We appreciate it.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Heron. That brings us to item 11.01. Rawls Bird Renaming Committee Report. Dr. Heron.
Thank you, Madam Chair. As you know, the board approved a process for the renaming of Rawls Bird Elementary School that included the creation of a renaming committee. And this evening we have members of the committee to present to you tonight, and Ms. Overkamp-Smith will introduce the item. Thank you.
Good morning. Good afternoon. Good evening. Let's pick a day.
Went through the whole day.
Madam Chair, members of the board, Dr. Heron, tonight we're here to present the results of the Rawls Bird Elementary Renaming Committee. We had a very good cross-section of members, and tonight members of the committee will be presenting different elements of our proposal. I would like to take a minute just to thank our committee. We had a great committee willing to put the work in and also had some very interesting discussions surrounding how we could best get input for our recommendations. So we're going to start with Mr. Lafayette Jones in background, then I will give a committee overview. Amy Gaunt will provide information on the school process. Felicia Highland will talk about community input. The recommended names will be presented by Karen Mason, Karen Peterson, and Jamie Bell, and then Principal Karen Swan will end our presentation. Mr. Jones.
Greetings, ladies and gentlemen of the board and Dr. Heron. I am Lafayette Jones, Jr., retired Colonel of the United States Army, where I served as a counterintelligence special agent, and I was also a member of the vaunted Green Berets. In 1960, when I was a high school senior, I requested to attend the all-white James Blair High School located on Ironbound Road, which was across the street from my home, in lieu of the all-black Bruton Heights School, which was located across town. This resulted in my father, a carpenter, receiving a telephone call from Mr. Rawls Bird, the superintendent of Williamsburg, James City County School System, informing him that if I did not rescind my request, my father would never work in the area again. On that same day, Mr. Bird called an impromptu meeting for all the staff and employees at Bruton High School and told them that if I kept trying to attend James Blair, that he would shut down the school and fire all the employees. On April 19th, 2016, Lafayette Jones, Edith Hurd, and members of the Bruton Heights alumni submitted a proposal to the board requesting that a name change be made. This request for a name change had been submitted because of Mr. Bird's staunch racist behavior. He had a completely antagonistic view towards non-whites, and he also had a complete disregard and non-compliance with federal law for more than 12 years. And this was the federal law I'm talking about is the 1954 Supreme Court decision that said that all schools should be integrated most expeditiously. Subsequently, the board resolved to change the name and appointed a committee to accomplish this action. At this time, I'll be followed by Ms. Betsy Overkamp-Smith, who will cover the committee overview.
The first step of the committee was to review our charge. We were tasked by the school board to come up with three recommended names to get input from both the school community and the external community to identify names and then to give you a recommendation. We met four times. We first needed to cull down into a couple of choices because we could have had a survey that had hundreds of choices and not moved forward on our recommendation of names. So we started with the school. We started with students, and we got their input, and Ms. Amy Gaunt is going to share that process with you.
Good evening. First, we started by having Ms. Swan, our principal, have a staff meeting to basically share our voting process. I want to point out that this entire voting process happened the week of Halloween, when Halloween fell on a Monday. And by that Friday, we had, first of all, each class generated their own class idea for a name. And in speaking of that, Karen Mason, another teacher in the school in the higher levels, and myself sat down to try and come up with a soundbite to share with the children and the teachers. I teach kindergarten. And my soundbite was the following. Rawls Bird was a person that our school was named for a long time ago. He made some bad choices. He chose to keep people apart instead of bringing them together. We want to give our school a new positive and meaningful name. Keep it simple. In kindergarten, that's what we do. Ms. Mason's was very spot on as well. Her soundbite was, our school opened in 1965 and is named after a retired school superintendent, Rawls Bird. Segregation, the separation of the races, was ruled to be illegal by the Supreme Court in 1954. Mr. Rawls Bird resisted against desegregation right here in Williamsburg. He did not believe that white students should go to school with people of color. Mr. Rawls Bird may have done many good things for our school system and community when he was in office, but he grew up in a different time. People were very afraid of change because they did not know what would happen. Today, our school has a very diverse community. We all share in the success of our school by realizing how we are alike and celebrating our differences. Mr. Rawls Bird did not understand this, and so we are changing the name of our school to reflect who we are now. We want your help in changing the name of our school. So we started by sharing that with the teachers. Each classroom came up with their own idea for the renaming, and then the grade level chose one of those, and so they voted on grade level as well. This is a great, great opportunity right before the election, and the kids really had fun with it. After the grade level idea, then we submitted those ideas to Ms. Swan and our administration, and then our entire school voted on those. And so by that Friday, we had our names. And then next, I would like to introduce Felicia Highland. She's going to speak to you about our community survey involvement. Thank you.
Good evening. I'm going to talk to you a little bit about the process or the steps that we took to engage the community in the process. Based on the eight names that we received that were identified by the school, we developed an online poll to garner feedback from the greater community. The poll included the selections that we received from the school, and we also added an option for a write-in along with comments so that an individual could write in a name that they selected and then provide any information regarding that name. From there, we took the created a link and posted that on our on social media, on the school website, and the division website as well. We created a flyer which included a QR code and also had a link. Tried to make it pretty so that when we posted it in the community that people would be drawn to it and pay attention. So the flyer was distributed through our Peach Jar e-flyer system, and then we also distributed it throughout the community so that we could engage WJCC families and the greater community. A paper version of the flyer was created in the form of a postcard because we recognize that not everyone has access to a computer readily. So we wanted to make sure we had a paper version as well. From there, we reached out to our community partners, supporters, and friends in the community to help us to get the word out about the poll. The flyer was emailed to all of our division partners, people like the Chamber, PTA Council, and the Williamsburg Regional Library were asked to display it in public places for us, as well as distribute it through their channels. We, various affiliate organizations, such as like the Kiwanis Club, Neighborhood Council, were also given the flyer and asked if they could help us to get the word out. And we also provided postcards to them so that they could have their members complete a paper version of that if that was more convenient. Flyers and postcards were posted throughout the community in places like Starbucks, the U.S. Post Office, Trader Joe, so that we could just kind of, you know, we wanted the input of our entire community, so we posted it in places that people go. Our partners in the faith community helped us out by including this in their weekly announcements. They distributed paper copies to their members as well. We received over 1,000 votes on the 8 selected names from the schools and over 800 votes for other names. The committee took a look at the results as well as the input from stakeholders and selected 3 names for consideration for the school board. The first recommended name is Sarah G.B. Jones Elementary, and committee member Karen Mason will tell us more about that selection.
Good evening. I'm Karen Mason. This is my 32nd school year, so I have earned every gray hair on my head. My students took looking for a name for our school very seriously. After we read the statement earlier that Ms. Gaunt read to you, we talked about wanting inclusivity. We wanted someone who included everyone in their lives, and we wanted someone who helped their community. So my students searched a site called Encyclopedia of Virginia to find a person worthy of naming our school after. After much discussion, they chose Sarah Garland Boyd Jones. Sarah Garland Boyd Jones lived from 1866 to 1905. Although Sarah was born in the 19th century, she exhibited many of the character traits we would like to see in our 21st century students. Sarah and her husband, Miles, began a life of service as teachers in Richmond, Virginia. When the Richmond Public Schools passed a law that black men could not be teachers, Sarah and her husband showed perseverance in helping their community by becoming doctors. Sarah was the first black woman to pass the medical exam in Virginia. She showed academic excellence by earning a high score in the surgical and hygiene part of the exam. Dr. Sarah and her husband set up a medical practice in Richmond. Dr. Sarah served women and children because she was determined to lower the mortality rates in her community. Dr. Sarah Jones also treated black and white patients because she wanted to help everyone. She was indeed inclusive. The doctors Jones, determined to make a difference, began a medical association for black doctors to collaborate and share medical information. Dr. Sarah Jones showed leadership in opening a hospital for women. This led to training nurses and starting a nursing school. At the time of her death, Dr. Sarah Garland Boyd Jones was known to be an excellent diagnostician and was well respected in her community by both her black and white patients. She is a person who our students can look up to and be proud of. She lived a life of service in her community and left a legacy of good health for the citizens of Virginia. Determination, academic excellence, resilience, leadership, and collaboration are the traits Dr. Sarah Garland Boyd Jones exhibited that made her an excellent candidate to name our school after.
Good evening. I'm Karen Peterson, and I am, as part of the committee, will be presenting the next name choice for consideration. The third grade students at Rawlsbird Elementary collectively decided on and submitted the name Glasshouse Elementary. The name is not an immediately intuitive choice based on the school's architecture or other defining characteristics, but rather is in reference to the glass house at nearby historic Jamestown. The students had been learning that part of Virginia Company of London's goal for profitability and success in their adventure to the New World was a plan to have the settlers make glass to return to England, as it was a scarce and expensive commodity. As part of its initial trial in 1609, the English company brought Dutchmen, Germans, and Poles specifically for the skilled task of glassmaking. During a secondary trial in 1622, Italian glassblowers were brought to the colony. There is extant archaeological evidence that these groups set up furnaces in a dedicated facility in their attempts at a glass production industry. In 1619, the colonists were granted the opportunity to begin making governing decisions for themselves by voting for representatives in the Virginia Assembly. Considered foreigners, the Poles were denied the right to vote in June of that year. In the country's first recorded act of civil disobedience, they refused to work until given the right to vote. The result of the labor strike was economic chaos, and almost immediately, in July of that same year, they were bestowed the full rights of any English citizen, including the right to vote. Additionally, by proving invaluable to the economic success of the colony, they were not required to attend the Anglican Church and were allowed to practice Catholicism. This was a stepping stone for freedom of religion in our country. Neither the Dutch, German, and Pole, nor the Italian glass production initiative was successful, as survival efforts likely consumed their days. Despite the failure, the Rawlsbird students have chosen Glasshouse Elementary as a name for their school because it is representative of hope and the dream of starting something new. The civic engagement in 1619 is considered a building block of America's democracy and is a positive reflection of our country's history, the early integration of different peoples and cultures working cooperatively to achieve a dream. Jamie Bell will present the next name choice.
My name's Jamie, and I am a parent at Rawlsbird. I am representing the name Laurel Lane Elementary School. As Joseph Carr has said, he said Rawlsbird Elementary has been on Laurel Lane for 51 years. It's a name we all know. And my favorite third grader, my daughter, she says it just rolls off the tongue. So, other than that, thoughts I have is during the urbanization of society, developers would name streets after landmarks or topographic features. Sometimes even saving the major streets to be named after themselves or their loved ones as a matter of pride and position. Many central streets would be given names resembling power or prominence and would be named after well-known heroes. During the suburbanization, should have practiced that word, of the United States during the 1950s, people were now obtaining properties with private yards. They were looking for a sense of community in the calm of nature as they began pursuing homes far from steel and the concrete of city. Developers began to name streets after trees and plants to highlight this new value. It's even still the practice of developers today to name streets in a way that highlights the desired traits they want associated with the neighborhood. Throughout modern and ancient history, the leaves of the laurel bush have represented strength and accomplishment. In Greek mythology and even in the original Olympic Games, the laurel wreath was a symbol of victory and triumph. This symbol became so synonymous with success that is even still used today in academia when individuals receive certain degrees, or in heraldry to represent a family as successful in their family crest, or even in ceremonies such as with the Boy Scouts and the Wreath of Service celebration to honor an individual for commitment and service. How fitting to name a school such as ours with a simple and known name that carries at the same time such strength and meaning. Through the long-standing success and accomplishment of our students, faculty, and staff of our school itself stands proudly as a symbol of strength and success. Beyond that, our school is a pivotal part of the foundation of our healthy community. And to end, as Campbell Sykes says, the name Laurel Lane would not cause any controversy. There's nothing bad about it.
Good Good evening, Madam Chair, the board, Dr. Heron. I appreciate the opportunity to be able to share with you all this evening. I'm most grateful to the members of this committee and the leadership and guidance of Mrs. Overkamp-Smith as well as Dr. Hyland. I get the treat of closing our presentation this evening, and I considered what I wanted to share. As the very proud principal of Rawlsburg Elementary School, there are two things that I hope are a reflection of our school. And the first was a little bit of affirmation this morning. I had a teacher that came in, and she wanted to give me a book gift. And it's called Love is All Around Virginia. And it mentions Williamsburg in it, but one of my hobbies is finding the love signs throughout Virginia. But more so, I think, and as she presented it, she shared that there's so much love within Rawlsburg. And that's something that I hope that we're able to instill and do every single day. The second thing that I hope that our school reflects came from Ms. Hunley earlier today. And it was the phrase, keeping the needs of children first. That's always something that we want to make sure that we are keeping at the forefront of what we do within our schools. And I think that Williamsburg, James City County Schools does just that. So then I go back to last summer, about 6 months ago, and our prepping and our planning as we get ready for the school year. There was some angst that came to our school with, who are we? Do we joke about the name change? Do we show anger? Do we show sadness? Do we reminisce on the decades? How do we capture these 50 years that happen to be changing in front of us so quickly? How do we face our personal feelings and yet keep a culture and climate that celebrates the joy of what we do? At the start of the year, quite a few materials are purchased, and often that includes dealing with the school's name and our mascot. We found ourselves in a bit of a quandary with what to put on things and how much of what to purchase. Do we make shirts? What do we put on it? This continues to be a topic of discussion with anything that needs a school label and a tag. And the thoughts and feelings still run very strong throughout the community about what should occur and why it's occurring. It's been quite a journey learning what the community members, families, staff, and students feel. And you want to acknowledge those feelings. They're real and they matter. So I want to take a moment on behalf of our school community to say thank you, thank you, thank you for allowing us to keep the penguin as our mascot. Change isn't easy and it can be messy, but the small bit of consistency is bringing a lot of peace in the midst of unknowns for us. I could become deep about the metaphor of what the penguin is to us and what it symbolizes, but I'm going to keep it surface and familiar, which is we just love penguins. We love the play on the word, penguining, pen-grinning, penguiners, and it's hard not to smile about penguins. So while any of our staff and families would agree that it is about a feeling that we create at our school, having our mascot remain keeps us less worried, in a less worried state, and it gives us an identity, and it makes us feel like our voices have been heard throughout this process. So thank you all again.
That ends our presentation. Does the board have any questions for any member of the committee?
So before we go into questions, I wanted to say typically the mascots and so forth are school building level decisions. So we're glad that that the penguin gets to stay at Rawlsburg. But before we ask the committee questions, I wanted to suggest for your consideration that we ask as many questions as we like tonight, but then take up this item at our work session in February, and then for potential action at the second meeting in February. So I'd like to throw that idea out there for your consideration. Mr. Kelly?
Thank you, Madam Chair. A couple of comments on the presentation. While I saw the penguin throughout, and I was really kind of hoping the penguin was going to be there. There's a little part of me that wanted Mrs. Swan to come up and talk about a big white bird that floats on lakes. Thought that would have been kind of fun, but anyway, and Mrs. Mason's comment, I just wish I had gray hair.
it will come.
I'd, Keeping it simple was always good, both in kindergarten and beyond. I want to thank you all, thank you for a considered and thoughtful process, engaging the community. It is important that the community know that this was not done in a quick manner. It was stable and sober, and there was a lot of inclusivity and the 1,000 votes. I think that was very good. So I just want to compliment you, Mrs. Overkamp-Smith, and the rest of your committee for what appears to be a job very well done and very thoughtful and very considered. And so I appreciate that process.
Yeah, I just finished watching, it's ironic, I just finished watching Happy Feet today. And my grandchildren were saying, Grandma, you haven't watched it. So I finally indulged. And I think this is an amazing process. I want to thank Mr. Jones for having he and his group spearheading this change. I think it's needed. And I want to thank the committee for being serious about it, and hopefully this is going to be a great change for the school.
Zombie?
Great job.
I agree. I know this is, it's tough, the history, and when I first moved back here in 2003, it was like, oh, Rawlsburg is just such a sweet family school. So the whole, not even knowing who Rawlsburg is, when you say Rawlsburg, in my mind, it was always the school and not the person. And so I think that for all of us that didn't know the history, it was always about the school. So I know that it's tough to go through a process like this, but I think the way you did it and the way the students were involved, the community was involved, is just great. And I really like the suggestions, so good job.
Ms. Taylor?
Yes, I also wanted to thank the renaming committee and the school community for all you've done and the patience you've had with us and your dedication to this process. We appreciate it.
So is everybody okay with moving forward in that way? Up at our next work session?
Yes.
Okay. Well, I'd like to echo the thanks to the entire committee for not only doing the work but being here tonight. That shows tremendous dedication and taking the time to explain it to us, but also to the public, the process, the thoughtful process that you went through. So thank you. Please thank your school community, and we really do appreciate it.
Thank you.
That brings us to 12.01, board member comments.
Yes, I had the opportunity this morning of participating in the awarding of the checks to the teachers, and I had been told that the best part would be seeing the students' faces, and it was really fun as we walked by the library in Lafayette, seeing students wondering what in the world all of these grown-ups were doing in their school, but to see the expression of students and how excited they were was truly amazing, and so I want to thank the Williamsburg Foundation for that.
Do you have any?
I do. I just wanted to share with the community. I had an opportunity yesterday to attend the NAACP MLK AXO award event and was just floored and honored to be around such talented youth, WJCC high schoolers as well as some regional youth. And not only do they perform at high levels academically, but they're involved in their community and with extracurricular activities. And these students are our future and have it going on way more than I ever did or even do today. I was just amazed. And then, like Mrs. Young said, I had an opportunity to travel on the bus today and present checks. And I see one of our phenomenal teachers here, Hocus Pocus, Now We Focus. Fidget box. And so I was at James River at Matoka and CBB and Rawlsburg, and it was a phenomenal experience. And thank the foundation for all their hard work. And a small grant can provide wonderful innovation. We have fantastic teachers who can take a little bit of money and do some phenomenal things. So that really was great.
Mr. Kelly?
I just want to thank the Jamestown school spotlight tonight. I think that's an exceptional club, and great program, and I really do encourage that being expanded to our other, at least our other high schools and beyond as we get there, because I think that's just great. Foundation grants, one of my top three or five events of the year, going to put graduation in there, teacher of the year, that kind of stuff, but it's just great to go out and get into schools and show and really show off our schools to the donors. I know Councilman Benny Zong was there, and showing him the murals at Stonehouse and the engagement of our kids, I think is really good for our funding partners to see that. And I love taking selfies with mascots. We had a great budget retreat this weekend. Probably not a lot of the news that we want to hear as far as the budget and coming out of the General Assembly. I have said and will continue to say that the problem with funding of public schools in the Commonwealth is not at the city and the county level, but at the General Assembly level, and I hope that they will see the need to appropriately fund public education in the Commonwealth, and that it's an investment in our future and an investment in our economy. I think it's important. The General Assembly has told us that we need to put out a budget of need. We work well with our funding partners, and I think we should continue to do that. And I think it's also important that we focus on a budget of need. So, thank you.
Ms. Hummel? I just wanted to echo everybody else's comments. The last 4 days I've been in budget meetings, and then the AXO, the MLK morning with the NAACP, and then today with the foundation awards. And I must say, yesterday and today was a lot more fun than Saturday. And there are not enough sticky dots to go around, because when Ms. Overcamp Smith would give us our sticky dots to be able to, I mean, everything that the administration is coming forward and saying, the choices are really impossible. It's really hard to choose between a trailer at Jamestown and then expanding classrooms for our our Bright Beginnings group. It's really hard. These choices are very, very difficult. So it's much more fun to go around and be greeted by bands and be greeted by people that give you pom-poms. So anyway, it was lots of fun today. And the cheerleaders, the drum lines, the bands, it was just a feel-good morning. So anyway, that's it.
So to follow up on all those positive things, I was also honored to attend the AXO breakfast yesterday, and to honor students in our community and to hear all they've achieved at such young ages just leaves me in awe every time. I was also honored to attend the WJCC Foundation Grant Award ceremony this morning, although I didn't get to ride on the bus and have all the fun, but I got to be there in the morning, and I think it's truly a gift to know how invested our community is in our public education, and to know we have such dedicated and innovative teachers here in WJCC, and also the exceptional Eagles just warm my counselor heart to the core. I would love to see that expanded division-wide as well.
I would like to take this opportunity to congratulate Mr. Kelly on being appointed by the governor to the Board for Architects, Professional Engineers, Land Surveyors, yeah. Interior Designers, and Landscape Architects. I had to write that down. Anyway, so congratulations. We're delighted to have someone from the governor's administration on the dais with us. Wanted to thank staff for their exceptional work at the budget retreat. You make it easy for us to make hard decisions. I'm bringing my own dots next year. So, and you can't switch it up because I'm just going to buy them all.
So, it's got to be the right color.
Yeah, exactly. And then I did wanted to echo everybody's comments about both the NAACP AXO breakfast and the WJCC Schools Foundation's event. We've been it's been really an embarrassment of riches that we've been able to see in our community, and we've had the honor and privilege of being a part of those two events, and to see not only the quality students that we produce here in WJCC, but also the amazing support that we have from the community through philanthropy. Anyway, anything else? That brings us to 13.01, upcoming events, and that includes the VSBA Capital Conference on the 23rd in Richmond, and the following day on the 24th of January in Richmond also is VSBA new chair and new board member orientation. And then prior to that, on the 18th of January, the policy committee is meeting at 4 o'clock in room 309 at central office. And then item 13.02, upcoming meetings. We have a closed session with BWP Associates, our search firm, on the 23rd in room 309. And then I think it's of note between then and our February work session, we will meet to interview applicants for superintendent at undisclosed locations within the next 15 days. And then on February 7th, we will have our closed session at 6 o'clock in room 309 at James Blair, and followed by at 6:30, also on the 7th, in room 300 at James Blair, our work session and action items. And then on the 21st of February, we will have a closed session at 6 o'clock here at Stryker in the work session behind council chambers. And then at 6:30, we will convene here for a regularly scheduled meeting at 6:30 here in council chambers. So any questions about upcoming meetings or events? Okay. And with that, this meeting is now adjourned.